Hello, and welcome to the Sensibly Speaking podcast. This is Chris Shelton, the critical thinker at large. This is the Sensibly Speaking show number 73, brought to you on Stitcher, iTunes, Google Play, as well as with video on YouTube. We have some politics this week. Now, I have said earlier that I am backing away from partisan politics and talking about things from a partisan slant, and that is still very, very true. But I had an opportunity to do an interview this week, and this individual that I'm talking with, his name is Dr. Gleb Tsipursky, and he is a really interesting guy, actually, and I'll tell you a little bit more about him in a second. He has put together a Rationality in Politics project. And this is a nonpartisan project. This is not about conservative or liberal views or left-wing, right-wing, Democrat versus Republicans or independents or any of that kind of thing. This project aims to try to figure out ways and means to bring truth to politics from the point of view of us, not from the point of view of trying to change something with what the politicians are doing, but from the point of view of what we're doing. And how we can more easily discern what is the truth and how do we go about getting it. And so there are definitely some barriers in the way of that, as there always have been with politics. But we're going to talk about some things that have come up recently in politics that might be, you know, putting up a few roadblocks in the way of us being able to understand what's actually going on. And some disturbing trends that have been happening recently. And again, we're gonna cite examples from liberals and conservatives, from Democrats and Republicans. But none of this is meant to. This show is not about trying to push an agenda, other than sensibility, rationality, logic, and reason. So, with that in mind, and all my sort of, you know, cautions set up here. I'm sure I'm going to get plenty of comments anyway telling me, you know, all about how dare we, you know, use Trump as an example or Hillary as an example or this or that. But, you know, we're simply trying to, call it like we see it. And hopefully you will see our point in some of these things. Now, to my guest this week, Dr. Gleb Tsipursky is an assistant professor at Ohio State University, and he is a historian of behavioral science. And he is actually quite intelligent when it comes to psychology, cognitive theory, and has been applying that to the area of how people perceive social media. We talk about fake news. We're going to talk about what it is that appeals to people, what it is that they decide is true or not, you know, how they go about deciding that. It's fascinating stuff. And so anyway, he works at the Ohio State University in the Decision Sciences Collaborative and the History Department. And he is also the president of Intentional Insights, which is the group he set up in order to get this Rational Politics project going. And I'm putting in the show notes and links on YouTube a couple links to his website and to a guiding document he put together about this project. So without further ado, here is Dr. Tsipursky.
Thank you very much for being on my show.
Thank you so much for having me on the show.
Yeah, it should be interesting. So you've written quite a bit, actually. I've seen your Patreon page and your website and the work that you've been doing, and your interest is very much in bringing rationality to politics, which is no small order. I don't know if you realize the bite of the apple. It's big. You know, a lot of people choke on that.
Well, hey, I don't plan to do it, you know, in tomorrow.
Well, that's good. I'm glad that there are realistic expectations there. So let's talk about this. What is the overall purpose of the RAP or RAP project or Rationality in Politics? What What is the purpose of this project? What is it you want to accomplish?
Sure. Excellent question. So what I want to accomplish is nothing more, nothing less than having our politics be oriented toward truth, first of all, in letter and spirit, and we can talk about that, rather than winning political battles. Now, the reason, yes, I know, sounds audacious, to say the least.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that I started this project was because of our current post-truth moment. And by post-truth, so the Oxford Dictionary picked post-truth as its word of the year in 2016. And it refers to post-truth as denoting circumstances where appeals to emotions and personal beliefs are much more important than objective facts. So that's what post-truth is. Now, we've certainly had politicians lie before, all
mm-hmm.
the time.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened previously is that when they got caught lying, they were embarrassed and they backed away from lies, and the media were generally trusted to be mediators between the two. You know, when you have a politician saying, you know, the Republican is lying, and another politician saying the Democrat is lying, then the media comes in and says, no, the Democrat is lying. The Democrat says, oops, okay, I lied, so let me back away from that. What's happening now in this post-truth era, especially with the rise of the Tea Party and the birther movement, but especially with the mainstreaming of post-truth politics with Trump, is that people aren't backing away from lies. They are doubling down on lies, and they're saying, yes, let's lie more. And they say things which convey that they know they're lying and they don't care.
Mm. Let's go ahead and talk about this for a minute, because this is actually a very important foundation on which, you know, your platform or your movement here is based, right? This business of post-truth. I think there are some people who would think, oh, it's not that bad. Oh, it's, you know, politics has always been dirty pool. Politics has always been, you know, all about, you know, manipulation and lies and this sort of thing. So what's so different about what's happening now? Do you have any specific example you might be able to point to that might illustrate what you're talking about?
Sure. So let's talk about when Trump, in the beginning of his speech, of his campaign, said, oh, all Mexicans, he implied that the large majority of Mexicans are rapists, criminals, and drug addicts, and drug dealers, and a small number of them are good people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's happening in that statement? Let's pick apart that statement. That's the nutshell idea. He's basically taking the whole huge group of Mexicans in the United States and who are undocumented aliens, illegal immigrants, whatever you call them, and let's say, I think there are something like 10 million of them.
Yes.
And he's saying they are all, the large majority of them are drug dealers, criminals, rapists, and so on. Now, that's factually not true.
Mm-hmm.
We have statistics showing that the crimes they commit are actually less than the crimes committed by the average American citizen. So he's taking a broad brush approach. He's causing people to really dislike Mexicans and as a whole group, as a whole category. When he's called out on it, previous politicians who would make statements like that, when they're called out on it, they back away. He doesn't. He doubles down. He says, no, I disagree. I reject your reality and try to substitute my own. What happens when that sort of thing goes on? Well, why do voters listen to him? It's because he appeals to their emotions. He appeals to their concerns. Concerns about crime, concerns about violence, concerns about sexual violation, and racist concerns, definitely. A lot of racism goes on around Mexicans, and it's tempting for people to believe that about Mexicans and other people from South America. So Trump, by doubling down on that, by rejecting the actual reality, appeals to the emotions of those voters. Now, so this is a really different situation than was the case before, because previously politicians who were called out on such lies, mainstream politicians, backed away from them. So this is a distinct thing. So this is the new thing. Now, that's one aspect of your question. The other aspect of your question is, why is this important?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the two aspects of the question. Why is it new and why is it important? The reason it's important is if politicians like Trump and others are able to get away with lying and doubling down on lies, we're essentially heading down a road toward corruption and authoritarianism. Why? Right. Why is that the case? You know, I'm making a claim here. So why is this claim backed up by evidence? Well, let's look at what happens. What does corruption mean? Corruption means that government officials are in cahoots with businesses and they're not actually serving the public interest. And authoritarian means that they're holding power in a way that's not backed by the representation of the citizenry. So they're not changing power. They're not giving up power to others. So those are kind of the nutshell definitions of corruption and authoritarianism.
Mm-hmm.
If a politician is able to tell people lies and still be elected, he doesn't or she doesn't need to care about what people actually think, about what people's interests actually are, and doesn't need to serve them. You can just get away with telling lies and saying, blah, 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 you know, X is Y, apples are pears, and elect me because this specific demographic is bad.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yep. Now, on this point, I think we see, you know, it's easy for us to jump to Trump as an extremely blatant example of this. And of course, all the Trump supporters always, you know, have a fit when that happens. So let's also talk about the fact that this goes on the other side of the political aisle as well. Did you notice or observe any such instances of this with the Democrats?
With the Democrats, it's usually more rare. And I'm not talking as a kind of not trying to say, oh, it's biased, Democrats are good. It's just that this is not a practice that Democrats are known for. Mm-hmm. They tend to, when they're called out on lies, they tend to back away from them.
Mm-hmm.
Because their base, their supporters, tends to do fact checking and tends to care much more about the truth. So this is a reason why fake news are much more rarely shared by liberals than by conservatives.
Mm.
You know, there are, if you, you know, read the accounts of fake news producers, people who produce fake news, most of them do so just for the money.
Mm-hmm.
They get a lot of money from producing fake news because fake news gets people to go to their websites, which have advertisements, and the people who are producers of fake news get money because people click on advertisements.
Right.
That's how the industry works in a nutshell.
Right.
So the people in that industry write fake news that's targeted mainly for conservatives, and they were interviewed, and they were asked if they tried to write fake news for liberals. And they described how, yes, we tried to write fake news for liberals, but it just wouldn't spread very well because liberals tend to fact-check much more, so it's and debunk fake news. It's not very lucrative to write for liberals.
It's interesting. It's an interesting thing because I actually read articles saying the exact same thing and went over that on this podcast. And I don't know if people totally got that or not. But it is. But it's a reported piece of information. You know, it is a thing out there that when you investigate fake news. Now, fake news. Now, let's be very, very clear about fake news as well, because Trump is now muddying the waters on what is fake news right now as of his news press conference yesterday. So fake news, as far as I'll define it here or put forward here, is when you have websites or media channels that look like and present themselves as though they are news, as though they are legitimate, accredited news sources or are presenting themselves not as opinion pieces, but as legitimate sources of factual information. And yet, they are not actually that. It is a deception. They are making the news up off the top of their head. They are putting clickbait articles out there solely for the purpose of generating clicks, of people looking at them and spreading them, right? They want likes, they want shares. And the more of that they get, the more successful they are, because like we just talked about, the more revenue they generate for themselves. And this has been shown in numerous media reports on this matter to be lucrative to the point of tens of thousands of dollars a month, enriching these people who are literally making up stories that have you know, no basis in fact. They'll take a little kernel of something that happened or is true, exaggerate it, blow it up, tell a lie about it, put some crazy headline there and throw it out there, and people share this all over social media. So that is what we're talking about when we talk about fake news. We're not talking about a legitimate news source like CNN, MSNBC, or you know, the New York Times or the Washington Post or these like accredited news sources who may or may not get a story right or wrong. That's not fake news. If you get something wrong, okay, you get it wrong, you print a retraction. It happens all the time. It's not, you wouldn't classify that in the same category as you would those fake news sites I was just talking about. Do you agree with what I just said?
I absolutely agree with what you just said. And to add to the list of real news, we would want to also think about things like the Wall Street Journal and Fox News, which are conservative news sources, but they do investigative journalism, and they sometimes report things that other news media sources wouldn't report.
Yes, and that's, very much so. Yeah, very much so. In fact, I think maybe one thing we might want to actually add into this is they are held to legal standards of journalistic integrity that can be enforced by law, right? Whereas fake news sites, they're just somebody's blog. You can say whatever you want on those. You know, you're not, that nobody can take you to task or pull your journalism, you know, credentials because you put out some fake news site because you're just Joe Fake News Public, right? Yes. Whereas a reporter for the Washington Post or the New York Times, you know, or Wall Street Journal, if they knowingly put out something that is false, they're not going to be working anymore.
Right? Their career will be ruined.
Yeah, yes. There are consequences to those actions. So there is a difference in the regulation of, you know, legitimate news sites versus fake news sites. And that's why I believe it is a dangerous thing for the president-elect to equate, you know, legitimate news sources with fake news and start calling them out as being fake news, because you're saying this is the same as this when they are apples and oranges of difference.
Yes.
You know, so this is an important, this is just another one of this, maybe one of these points of rationality in politics that we need to make very, very clear, because it's, the lines are being blurred on purpose.
Yes.
By our, you know, incoming government elect. And that is a very dangerous, you know, direction that's being taken there. So,
absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, it's very dangerous. And it's something that the listeners of this show, who tend to be better educated than a typical person, might not recognize the immediate danger. Now, looking at the research, it's much more dangerous than, again, it might seem to a listener of this show. There was a study recently by Stanford University which showed that about 80% of students who are savvy users of social media can't differentiate between a Facebook-sponsored story, so an advertisement, in other words, and a news story shared by their friends. Now, again, these are students. They are savvy social media users. And 80% of them can't tell apart that news story. That's horrifying.
Well, I'll tell you who thought that was good news were the advertisers.
Absolutely. I mean, they were happy.
They must have been definitely happy. High fives all around on that.
Absolutely. And yes. You know, it's good for Facebook business, of course. Facebook itself, not good for politics. You know, the Trump team was at the forefront of using sponsored advertisements in targeting voters. The Clinton social media team was not nearly as savvy as the Trump social media team. The Trump team was at the forefront of targeting voters with sponsored advertisements. So they were very effective and they were really research-based, very admirable in terms of strategy, in terms of winning.
Right. Interesting.
Yeah, and people are also very weak at actually distinguishing what makes a story credible or not. For example, again, on Facebook from the same study, the study discussed how people rated a story as more credible, not based on things like where it came from, the source of the story, but on things like the size of the photo associated with the story.
Really?
Yep.
Now that's an interesting piece of information.
Yes. I mean, it's because visual information, we can go into the psychology of this if you wish. I mean, basically the visual information is processed much more quickly by our brain than textual information. So when they look at a large photo and it seems impressive, they are more comfortable with it. And so they mistake this comfort for true value. Because it feels better to them, they believe it is more true.
Right.
And this basic difference between truth and comfort is something that the Rational Politics Project is very strongly oriented toward addressing. It's a fundamental mistake all human minds make.
Well, it is. And it's interesting. I just posted a video today talking about the lessons that we can learn from Scientology, which is something I was heavily involved in and now I'm an advocate against. And I listed five things that, you know, that harsh lessons that we should learn. And one of them being that because we are emotion-based, you know, when you're making important decisions in life, you really need to park your ego. You know, you really need to not be using that emotion side. And yet it is, you know, I know in saying that, that it is 1,000% against our nature, right? And this is the struggle. This is actually the heart of the matter when it comes to rationality and making rational decisions is the, you know, is that fighting that emotional creature that lives in us, you know, that a lot of people don't even know about, and so don't even try to fight it. They just go with what feels good. You know?
Yes, exactly. And that's the big danger. That's the big danger of going with what feels good, because those are two separate axes. Comfort and truth are two separate distinct things. They're not parallel. They are not the same thing. We mistake them for the same thing. Our brain tends to mistake them for the same thing. It's not something to blame ourselves for. It's just to realize that that's the natural human condition, you know, and we are just not given an education in that in school and by our parents, unless you had really awesome parents. And I hope your listeners had really awesome parents, but, you know I didn't have that education. I know I had to come to it from research, and, you know, this is why I write articles for intentionalinsights.org and talk about this as part of my work, because this is a fundamental failure mode that will, as we talked about, will likely lead to a great deal of corruption and authoritarianism and destroy our democracy as we know it, unless we do something about it.
Yeah, it's not hard to connect those dots, and yet for a lot of people, they don't connect those dots. They don't see how one thing leads to another and leads to another, or they won't believe that that is something that could happen or would happen. And I, you know, and you can make comparisons in history to tragic events or earlier things that are similar to that, and they go, give me a break. You know what I mean? Trump's not Hitler and this sort of thing. And I'm not, you know, and I want to, when I say something like that, this is not Trump bashing. That's not what I'm doing right now, because I don't like and did not support Hillary much. You know, but I didn't want her either. You know, our last election was not a good choice either way. Now we've got who we've got. So this is not sour apples. This is not a matter of, you know, me trying to be a sore loser or push some agenda here. I have to clarify that, because people jump all over this so quickly. But there's just the fact that that there are indications of, you know, things happening right now that are warning signs of worse things to come if we are not aware of that. Now, just being aware of it and taking some action now can prevent that sort of thing in the future, or we ignore it, say it can't happen, say there's no way something like that could ever occur, and then guess what? It happens. You know?
Absolutely. That's absolutely right, Chris. There is a really great book called The Black Swan. I don't know if you're a reader.
I have read it.
Okay, yes. So then, but for your listeners who might not have heard about it. So the Black Swan talks about things that we can't predict because they're not within our capacity of our imagination. The large majority of Americans living in a corrupt authoritarian society is not within the capacity of their imagination. I study the history of behavioral science. One of my areas of research is the Soviet Union and post-Soviet Russia. So I saw a country go from a Tsarist state in 1917 to a brief period of democracy between the Tsarist period and the Bolshevik Revolution to a really authoritarian regime under the Soviet Union, then a fledgling democracy in the 1990s, and again into an authoritarian regime with Putin. Now, if you ask people in Russia, let's say in the mid-1990s, will Russia become authoritarian? They would have said, no, no way. We just left authoritarianism behind. There's no way we're going to go there. And then it happened. Putin came to power. He became an authoritarian. You know, another example is, let's say you have a turkey, and this is a good example that's described in the Black Swan. And the turkey lives its whole life, and, you know, gets nice meals and so on, and expects that the rest of its life it will keep getting nice meals. There's no reason why it will not be housed in a nice place and get a nice meal.
To clarify, this being a turkey on a farm, not some wild turkey. This is a turkey being raised by a farmer, being fed every day, and he's thinking, hey, man, I'm getting paid, I'm getting food, I'm getting shelter. Like, what reason would that turkey have to think that something's going to change?
Yep. And then one day it goes to the White House, and then, you know, it sees another turkey. And you know what happens with the turkey day in the White House? One of those turkeys will be forgiven, and one of those turkeys will be killed. And the question is, which turkey do you want to be? Do you want to be the
Exactly. And but the point, of course, being that that within the experience of the turkey, as far as he was concerned, there was no way he could have imagined that he was being fattened up and raised his entire life to be eaten.
Right.
You know, so it was just beyond his ken and beyond his experience. And yet, that was the reality. If you objectively look at what was going on, that's what's happening, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's kind of the appeal that we're trying to make here in talking about these things, is we're not trying to be partisan. We're not trying to, you know, be on one side or the other or throw a bunch of labels around. We're trying to appeal to, you know, a reasonable look at what is going on, you know? So,
and that's the danger. The danger doesn't come from Trump as an individual or his policies. It comes from the political methods that he's made mainstream. And he didn't originate those political methods. Like I said, they came from before him. You had the birther conspiracy, which was the real major point when post-truth politics became a point of importance in America. It's just that Trump is the first mainstream politician. Now, you could have had another politician who brought post-truth politics into the mainstream. Trump just happens to be that person.
Right, right. And it is a dangerous trend, because now that it has put a person into the Oval Office, other politicians are now going to follow suit and think, this is the successful way for me to present myself and change hearts and minds, is by not denying lies, but doubling down on them. And, you know, I don't care what you think, this is how it is, when in fact, that's not how it is at all.
Yes. And you're absolutely right, Chris. And we even see Democrats starting to adopt this. So this is not only a Republican thing.
This is not a partisan thing.
To be clear,
yeah.
The Democrats are looking at Trump and they're saying, oh, that was a successful strategy. Let's adopt some of this populist, misleading rhetoric in our own political activities. Right. And so the Democrats are doing this. The Republicans, who were previously opposed to Trump, doing it. You know, nothing succeeds like success, right? Where you see people like Romney, who are very anti-Trump, now coming on board, and others as well.
Right.
So what do we see happening? We see Democrats adopting some of these tactics. We see Republicans adopting a lot more. And the tactics themselves are well-suited to winning. They are quite effective. Mm-hmm. So if you just want to win, that totally makes sense for you to use those tactics. Mm-hmm. However, what's happening with that sort of situation is that the whole system is being undermined. It's like pollution. Someone starts polluting, and then everybody else says, oh, wait, why do I have to clean up? Why do I have to spend extra expenses on, you know, cleaning up my fuel? And they go the Volkswagen way and, you know, just shut off their cleaners, their air cleaners, and they go much faster, and they win. They win, you know, just like Volkswagen won customers by doing that, by doing an illegal thing. This is not technically an illegal thing, but they are winning political battles by doing so.
Mm-hmm.
And the result is increasing amounts of pollution. You know, in that case, it's increasing amounts of pollution of the environment. In this case, it's an increasing amount of pollution of truth in our political system.
Right.
So people don't know what's true or not. And because politicians tell them that they shouldn't care, the politicians they trust, they're just not caring about what is true or not. They're like, well, this feels comfortable for me to believe, and therefore I will believe this thing. There are plenty of polls saying that a lot, let's go again to Republicans, because they are the ones currently most influenced by this post-truth politics. The large majority of Republicans, so let me say this more clearly, there's on the majority of Trump voters currently believe he won the popular vote.
Which is factually not true.
Which is factually not true. But why is this an important thing to look at? Trump claimed in numerous times that he won the popular vote, despite this being not true. If Republicans who voted for him believe that he won the popular vote, they will see him as more legitimate than he is. And therefore, they will give him more leeway and more credibility.
Right.
And he has more power. And this, again, credibility, power is leading toward authoritarianism. If you think of a scale of authoritarianism from 0 to 100, he's moving up that scale by claiming that sort of credibility. If he can do this now, and he's successful in doing it now, what will he do in the future? In the future, can it be the case that in an election that he would not win, he would claim that he actually won and he would not give up power? Can he say in the future, in 4 years from now, that, well, you know, I would have won this election except for the millions of illegal voters who voted, which is what he's claiming right now, and therefore I will not give up power as president? How many people will support that? 4 more years of Trump, he's already making these claims right now that he won the popular vote, except the illegal voters.
Right.
How likely? Would you be surprised if in 4 more years, when he gathers more power and more credibility, if he makes that claim when he loses to some Democrat? If he loses, but let's say if he loses to some Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
How surprised would you be?
Yeah, exactly. It's an interesting thing, you know, because historically speaking, this happens all the time, but there's this credulity factor or something that people have this idea that because we live in the best of times, because we're so much smarter than everybody in history, because we're, you know, standing on the shoulders of all these people before us and all this, and we're the best and the brightest and all that, and modern technology and civilization, that we are incapable of making the mistakes that have been made in the past by human beings. And I just... You know, you just like, no, please stop thinking that way. We have not moved forward that far over the last, you know, 4,000 years. So please, you know. All right, let's get into this next point, because this is important. You have identified, and, you know, you wrote this whole guiding paper for your project, and I'm linking it in the show notes on this website. On the podcast here, but you've identified the exact problems now in communicating to large audiences, which is that they are not so interested in facts. And it's not to be insulting, it's just a fact. It's just a how do you manipulate a group of people? Well, you don't necessarily feed them a bunch of facts. Instead, you convince them with appeals to their emotion. What, you know, you get them, gah, gah, gah. Now, we can always look to Hitler as the ultimate example of this with his anger rhetoric and rah, rah, you know, and his Nuremberg, you know, addresses and this sort of thing. But this is any political rally, from a local rally to a national, you know, to the primaries and, you know, to the national elections. This is what goes on, is there's all kinds of screaming and yelling. Whereas if it was very fact-based, you know, it would be kind of boring. The politicians would stand there and, well, I'm going to do X, and then I'm going to do Y, and here's how I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to do Z, and everybody would just sort of nod. Yes, that sounds like a very good idea. I'm very interested in that. Like that,
the Lincoln-Douglas debate model.
Yeah, it would look very different. So people want to be entertained. They want it to be a spectacle. They want the corn and games and that sort of thing. But you mentioned this, you talk about this in your document, and you say that it's hard to actually get support for what you're trying to do in bringing a rational approach to politics, because the people who want to support rationality in politics don't want to use the emotion-based engaging communication. It's kind of an interesting little thing. Like we know this is what changes hearts and minds, but, you know, no, we can't really position ourselves that way because, you know, we're trying to be the rational people, but nobody really cares about being rational. So it's sort of this whole, you know, so what's your, now that I've put this out there, what are the nuts and bolts of this? What's your plan to deal with this?
Sure. Great questions. So you're right. This is the basic fundamental mode of people who try to promote truth and reason. So, you know, I'm not the first person who has been trying to promote truth and reason and rational thinking by far. Now, what usually happens with folks who try to be activists for reason and rationality is that they use arguments and debates and logic and reason, like you and I are here having a reasonable, logical discussion. And what results is that it appeals only to people like you and I and your listeners.
Right. Exactly.
And let me say this, you know, I hate to burst your bubble or the bubble of your listeners, but we ain't the majority.
Exactly.
We ain't the majority of the American public. We are outliers, and we have to recognize that we're outliers. We are outliers on the reason spectrum. We are much more oriented by our genes and our memes, so both our genetic heritage and our upbringing, to be much more oriented toward reason than Joe Public, than the typical member of the audience who we want to target. So that's why the large majority of the reason movement, of people who care about reason and rationality, speak only to other people who care about reason and rationality. And they speak within their own filter bubble. They speak within an echo chamber. It doesn't really get to the people who don't care so much for reason and logic. And that includes a lot of liberals and even more conservatives.
Yes.
Now, there are certainly some reason-oriented conservatives who, and a few, are involved in the Rational Politics Project. But again, because of reasons discussed before, there tend to be right now more conservatives who are less oriented toward reason and logic.
Right.
In fact, as a result of Trump, recent polling shows that conservatives' belief in mainstream media credibility has dropped more than half from 2015 to 2016.
Wow.
So, which is, you know, ludicrous, but it's true.
Right.
So it's the Trump effect is very powerful. So what can we do? Well, people who care about reason and logic, and not simply for themselves, but who want a society that's a little bit more reasonable and a little bit more logical than it is right now, who want to go from this post-truth moment toward what I call the post-lies future, if we ever want to get there. What we need to do is speak to people where they are. And this is a basic principle of educational psychology. When you teach people, when you communicate to people. You want to figure out where they are, so what they where they are, what they care about, and how to reach them most effectively.
Mm.
So these three things. Now, where they are usually is not reason and logic. Where they are is in their values and their emotions, and their values and their emotions are not going to be similar to yours. I'll give you, so again, let me go for the principle and I'll give you an example.
Yep.
So their values, figure out what motivates them, what drives them, what words they care about, and use that language. Use the language that resonates with them, not the language that resonates with you, the language that resonates with them. And then figure out how to reach them where they currently are. So their venues, their channels, not again, not speaking to other reason-oriented people, but going out there and spreading the message in venues where you have to expand your comfort zone to be in that venue. You know, I don't have to be expand my comfort zone to talk with you here. You know, I love talking with you. This is, you know, my perfect, you know, very comfortable venue for me. But I'll give you an example of where I went to a place that's not comfortable. So I went on a radio show with Scott Sloan. Scott Sloan is a very prominent conservative radio show host here in Ohio. So I'm based in Ohio. And he had Donald Trump on his show shortly before he had me on his show. So it gives you an example of like how prominent he is. So I went on Scott Sloan's show and we talked about the Ohio State terror attack. So I'm a professor at Ohio State. If the listeners remember, there was a terror attack by a Somali Muslim who rammed his car into some students on Ohio State campus, then ran out and used a knife to attack some more people, and then he was shot by the police. So that happened about 2 months ago. So I went on Scott Sloan's show to talk about that because, you know, I knew all the Republicans, most Republicans would be seeing this as a bad, Muslims are bad sort of message. And indeed, this was some stuff that Donald Trump tweeted about this. Others talked about this, how this is radical Islamic terror. So I went on Scott Sloan's show and I talked to him about what is the actual situation. In 2015, we had about 6 terror attacks on U.S. soil by Muslims. Now, there are about 1.8 million adult Muslims in the United States. That means that you have about as much chance of an adult Muslim committing a terror attack in a given year, you know, of finding an adult Muslim who's a terrorist, as you have of picking out a terrorist from, you know, 5 football stadiums.
Mm-hmm.
So randomly pointing out a person from 5 football stadiums and saying that person's a terrorist is the same as looking at a Muslim and saying that person's a terrorist.
Right.
Basically, the filter of Muslim is a very bad filter for terrorist. The probability of if Muslim, then terrorist is, you know, very, 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 very low, minimally low. And I talked to him about, well, you know, we care about safety and security. We may feel fear and anger toward Muslims. Those are natural feelings to feel because of what's called in psychology the horns effect and the group attribution error. The horns effect causes us to spread negative feelings from one element of a whole to the broad whole. So that's as though you have horns.
Right.
So it's just a psychological phenomenon. The group attribution error causes us to spread feelings that we feel about one person in that group to the whole of the group.
Right.
So that those combined cause us to feel bad about this Muslim guy and spread all fear and anger toward every Muslim. However, this leads us to make wrong decisions that undermine our safety and security. They cause us to be less safe and secure if we waste our resources of safety and security, our secure resources, by looking at Muslims instead of looking at the actual terrorists.
Right.
Because there's going to be a huge number of people who are going to be caught in the net who are the wrong people, and actual terrorists will not be caught. So that's kind of one point. Then another point that I made was that the Muslim community will not help you if you persecute them. So that's just dumb to focus on Muslims because the vast majority aren't terrorists and they will be less likely to help us. And third of all, if we focus on Muslims and persecute them, more of them will become terrorists. ISIS and Al-Qaeda are already using Donald Trump's speeches as terror recruitment vehicles in videos trying to recruit Americans, Muslims, as terrorists. The more of that stuff we have, the more people will be recruited as terrorists.
Right.
So
I think if we put it in terms like, look, if you heard the same rhetoric about Muslims or Islam, if we took out the word Muslim and took out the word Islam and substituted Christian, what would the reaction be of people in this country? Mm-hmm. Right? They would obviously, very predictably, they would be outraged. They would be incensed. They would be upset. They would feel insulted. They would feel that they would have well, that's not me. How dare you say that sort of thing? And yet that they somehow can't seem to grasp that Islam or that Muslims would have that same reaction. Mm-hmm. They just can't seem to get it because they're like, no, they're all bad. And you go, dude, there is no such thing as an entire group of people that are millions in size that are all bad. It doesn't work that way. Yep. You know?
And I think you're making an argument from logic, and I hear you. But what I was doing was making an argument from security.
Right, right.
So, and no, this I'm is just, the difference.
Just throwing out a different viewpoint on the same thing.
Sure. No, I totally hear you. And I, from a logical perspective, I'm like, yes, totally. I agree with you, Chris. That's definitely the right logical thing. But if we want to appeal to conservatives, we need to speak to where they are. And that's security.
Mm.
You and I tend to be oriented toward truth and reason and logic. They don't care. They're like, well, if it gets us more security, let's persecute and bomb all the Muslims.
Right.
And that's something I heard plenty of conservatives say.
Right.
You know, and so how do you deal with that? You talk to them about what they care about, not about what we care about, not right. about logic, and not about civil rights. You talk to them about security. You're less secure. You are going to be killed. Your children are going to be killed. They're more likely to be killed if you persecute Muslims.
Right.
So instead of persecuting Muslims, you want to try to be nice toward them, because the vast majority of them are not terrorists. And if you are nasty to them, they are less likely to help you find the terrorists within the ranks, and more of them will become terrorists.
Well, there's a great example of what I just asked you about. So good job there.
Yes, and by the end of it, Scott Sloan was, you know, he updated his beliefs and he said, yes, it makes sense for us to not be so oriented toward calling Muslims terrorists and being nicer to Muslims. And this was a conservative radio show host. He's a very popular one. He has hundreds of thousands of listeners.
Yeah.
So reaching this guy with this interview is just illustrative of the kind of technique that reason-oriented people don't apply. It's not intuitive to us.
No,
but it's effective strategic communication. You need to, again, figure out where they are, what they care about, the words that they would care about, the words, their values, the words that they care about, and use this emotional engagement. It's all true. What I said is all true, but it's not framed in the way that we as reason-oriented people tend to hear it. It's very counterintuitive to me. It's counterintuitive to you. I'm sure it'll be counterintuitive to your listeners.
It's interesting, actually, about finding the emotional factor that will appeal to the person that you're talking to. And this would work individually or with groups. I've talked on earlier shows about the importance of keeping open lines of communication between opposition groups, right? This last election really threw me for a loop and really made me realize that a root cause of the divisiveness in this country is the failure of the opposing sides to recognize that both sides have pros and cons. Both sides have truth and lies mm-hmm. on their side. And if you're not willing to recognize that the person you're opposed to, the conservatives, the liberals, the reds, the blues, whatever, if you're not willing to recognize that there's something that they're looking at that actually does have some factual basis to it and does have some legitimacy to it, if it's all just, no, you're wrong, wrong, wrong on every single thing that you've ever said, ever, you're never going to mend fences. You're never going to create a middle ground. You're never going to move the ball down the road. And that is what democracy is all about, creating that middle ground.
I think creating the middle ground is an important component. I think I want to enrich that by talking a little bit about empathy. And empathy, not in the sense of sympathy, which is caring about what other people think, but empathy in the sense of understanding what other people feel. So sympathy refers to caring about what other people feel. Empathy refers to understanding what other people feel. And understanding other people's emotions gets you at truth. It is true that they feel the way they do. Right. It is true that they have different values than you do. You and I might not care so much about security, but research shows that people who tend to care about security tend to be more conservative. People who tend to care about purity tend to be more conservative, and so on. These are often genetic predispositions. So about 50% of our political leanings are determined by our genes, according to research. So scholars could predict with 75-degree accuracy, in other words, if they know your gene set, whether you're a conservative or a liberal.
Really?
Yes. That
is a completely new piece of information to me.
Oh, yeah, that is absolutely the case. You know, about 50% of our political leanings are shaped by our genes because of what we care about. If people, again, if they care about independence and autonomy, and that's the thing that a lot of conservatives care about, they tend to be in the conservative camp, in the libertarian side of things.
Hmm.
So if that's a value that they hold, and that's a genetically informed value, and also mimetically, so by our upbringing. But genes shape a large part of that, whether you tend to be an isolation-oriented person or not. And again, with other stuff, like we talked about, whether you care about others or not. So the more strongly you care about others, the more sympathy, in other words, you have toward them, the more likely you are to be a liberal.
Interesting. And,
yes, and that's genetically determined. Kind of that is also mimetically, but genetically a large part of that comes from genes.
Interesting.
So you need to figure out where people are and what they care about, what their genetic predisposition and mimetic predisposition leads them to value, where their values are. Because that is the truth of reality. It is the truth of the terrain of the human mind, the territory of the human mind. They don't have, literally, are their minds, other people's minds are not the same as our mind. And we need to figure out what other people's minds are like, what emotions they feel, what they care about, speak to them, and help them recognize that orienting toward truth would be in the best interests of everyone in the long run. So this is kind of the going back to the Republicans versus Democrats thing. Neither the Republicans nor the Democrats nor third parties are right now oriented toward truth in politics as a problem. They're oriented toward winning. And we see the Democrats are adopting some of the Trump-style rhetoric, populist rhetoric. And what is happening right now is essentially a situation that's called the tragedy of the commons. Now, the tragedy of the commons is a sociological phenomenon where a common shared resource is being taken over by specific groups, by specific interests. Pollution is a classic example. We have a shared resource of the environment, of clean air and earth and so on, and people who are polluting are taking it over and destroying it. Now, Trump-style post-truth rhetoric, and again, not only Trump, other people too, who adopt this post-truth-style rhetoric, are destroying truth in our democracy. They're polluting truth, essentially. And they're destroying trust in our political system, which will, in the end, lead to corruption and authoritarianism. Because, again, if politicians don't have to serve the public interest, they can stuff their pockets and they don't have to be transparent. And, if their incentives are for them to lie and still win, why not also get rich?
Well, exactly. And I want to be clear about something here, because this is not something that just started. We've had corruption in politics for decades, Absolutely. Centuries. Politics, you know, attracts people who are, you know, of a corrupt sort of mindset because of the nature of power and how power works and how influence peddling works. It's a magnet for those kind of personalities. So don't have any idea, God, I really wish we'd started with this, that everything we're talking about is some new thing that just started and, you know, oh my God, wow, it's a revelation that there's corruption in politics. No, we get it. We know that this has been a problem for a long time. Hillary, Bill, you know, going back long, long ways, you can find lots and lots of examples of politicians lying, politicians being, you know, on the take and that sort of thing. What we're talking about right now is a new phenomena where when they're caught and when they're called out on it, they don't back off. There's no, you know, the power of the media and the power of truth has been compromised. And that is a new thing.
That's absolutely right, Chris. Good point, bringing that up and highlighting it.
Yeah.
Yes, and we can see the example of that in Trump not releasing his tax returns. Very clear example. All previous presidents have released their tax returns.
Yes, yes.
And he didn't. All previous presidents have cut off their business associations, liquefied them, and we see from his recent conference that he'll have his sons run the business. And how many of us really believe that they will not communicate to Trump about their business interests?
Right. You know, and again, there's a lack of transparency. There's a show put on. Here's all these documents laid out on this table. But guess what? Not one of those reporters was allowed to look inside those envelopes. They could have been stuffed with reams of blank paper for all we know. It's there's an appearance of transparency, but there's not transparency. And there's
I like that. Transparency of transparency.
Yeah, there's a big difference, you know, between those things. So that's what we're talking about here. And this is another step on the road toward it's a step on a road that goes to a very dark place.
Yeah, and I think it's a more than a step. It's more like Neil Armstrong's giant leap.
I agree with you. I agree with you, which is why we spent this podcast talking about it. So we are running out of time, so I know that there are a lot of questions that people are going to have and a lot of things that they're going to want to know about what you're doing and the resources that you're putting together on this. So where can people go to find out more about what you're talking about?
Folks can go to intentionalinsights.org. So that's, again, intentionalinsights.org, and check out more about that. They can email me personally at Gleb, G-L-E-B, at intentionalinsights.org. And I'd be happy to chat with you, anyone who is interested in just finding out more about the project or participating in it. There are lots of opportunities to get involved.
Excellent. Okay, well, this has really been very educational. I really appreciate your time on this. And I don't doubt that we may very well be having further discussions in the future. I think this was fascinating.
I would enjoy further discussions as well. It's a very important topic.
Excellent.
Thank you again for having me on the show.
Yeah, thanks for your time.
And that was my interview. I hope you enjoyed listening to us ramble on about some of those things. It was certainly interesting and educational for me, and I hope it was for you as well. Please leave any comments, feedback, good, bad, or indifferent in the notes section below on YouTube or in the comments on sensiblyspeaking.com. Also, if you guys have been listening to this on iTunes, go ahead and give me a rating, a review on iTunes. I think I would really appreciate that. And otherwise, thank you very much for coming around, and I will see you, or you'll hear from me, next week. Bye-bye.